Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
Good.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Yeah? How many of you remember these palm branches from years past?
How many years past?
Well, let me see. I go back 73. But some of you go back further than that, I think, don't you? No? Oh, okay. Well, I'm the old one in the group. I remember as a kid getting the palm branches. And the first thing we wanted to do with the palm branches was to hit the kid next to you. And some of you are still kids. I know some of you are still being kids and doing it. And you know what? I think that's okay. I think that's okay. When we do the palm branches, we remember Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, and it was a party. It was a party. And we're going to talk a little bit about that before, and then we're going to end the service a little bit more somberly. But we're going to start with the remembrance of palms and the celebration and what that means to everybody. So thanks for being here today. I know you didn't have to be, but I think we've got things planned out for a very, very good service for you this morning. Some announcements this morning, if you wanted to turn on the back of your bulletin. Is this the back of your bulletin? No, yeah, on the back of the bulletin has your announcements. Don't forget Monday, Thursday. It's 6 o'clock here. And then next Sunday, we're going to have Easter services. Do you remember Easter? Do you remember Easter? And all the fun that was. And the celebration. And I never understood why every Easter we had ham. Somebody said, yeah. Do you know why he had ham?
No.
First of all, Jesus was a Jew. And the Jews don't eat
pork
or ham or anything like that. They don't. And well, that sounds kind of anti-productive, doesn't it? Well, except for the fact that Jesus overcame all the old rules. It was a new law. It was a new understanding. It was living faith by faith, not living it by the law or facts or other things. It's by doing it by love one another. And that's what Jesus was all about. So Easter Sunday was just a wonderful Sunday. Celebrate it. And Jacob Landis is going to be here. Yeah.
What does the palm have to do with Jesus?
What does the palm have to do with Jesus? When Jesus came into Jerusalem, some of them took off their cloaks and they laid them down. And the reason for that was that was what was done for a coronation. If a king was coming to be crowned king, they took off their coats and they laid them down in front of the king to come. The other thing they did is if they ran out of coats, I mean, how many coats do you usually carry? And you still want to celebrate, they took down the palms and they laid them in front of him as a sign of royalty and as a sign of the power of God coming. That's why the palms. Does it make sense? Good. Yeah. Then coming up, I understand that Ken Renks had a really good sermon last week, right? How many were here? No doubt the palms were getting in the way. No problem. Ken Renks, were you here last Sunday?
No, but we watched it on Facebook.
Okay, and it was a good service.
Wow.
Yeah, blew your mind, didn't it? Didn't it?
Did you watch it too?
No, I didn't. But I heard about it. I heard about it. So, and by the way, I didn't introduce myself. I'm George Wisnum. And I used to be pastor at Shannon United Methodist. And then I did, after retirement, I did Milledgeville, and I did Chadwick, and I did, Coleta. Pardon?
First Brother.
I did First Brother, and I was there for about a year. So these are some of the places I've been. So, and we do live in Lanark itself. So, right? Did I see you at the school the other day? Yeah, I thought I saw you at school a couple weeks ago. This young gentleman came up. I was walking my dog, and he was out there, I think, waiting for somebody. And I talked to him for just a moment, and he said, "Did you ever preach at our church?" Now, you know, for somebody just coming along, said, "Yeah, you sound like him." Now, how many people can remember that? You know, is my voice that distinctive? He's got a good memory. Is he attached to you somehow or other? Okay, my God. There's a family resemblance there. Anyway, I'm having too much fun. On the back, or in the inside of your bulletin, on the back side of it, attendance and offering, prayer requests. Remember Paul and Connie, Nyla and Jaleesa, Nancy, Catherine, Andrew, Albert, Kenny, Emily, Helen, and Don. Keep them in your prayers. Have you been keeping them in your prayers during the week? Do that, you know. Take this home. I had a wonderful gentleman in one of my congregations who used to take the bulletin home, and he stuck it in his Bible. And every morning, every afternoon, and every evening, he did some scripture study on his own. And every time he would take out those same names, and he would repeat them over again. He had a wonderful prayer life. And he really wasn't afraid of anything. So and I remember when he passed, I was with he and his wife, and he had a very bad contagious disease, so they stuck him in an isolation room with a big window. And he was dying. He was closing his eyes for the last time. And we thought he had closed his eyes, and suddenly his eyes opened real wide, and he smiled at all of us, and he went... What a fantastic faith. Yeah. So he had that as a prayer thing. He always did that. Let me recommend that to you. If you ever get afraid, you never have to be if you have Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. Don't need to be afraid. Okay, are there other announcements that need to be made? Yes.
there is a sympathy card back on the library counter back here for the... for Jacob and Leah Landis, for the loss of Leah's mother. We thought it would be nice if everyone would sign, and we'll send that sympathy card to them. So today, before you leave, please stop back and sign the card. There's also a sign-up sheet for Love Feast. We'd appreciate everybody who plans on coming to please sign up so that we have a basic estimate of how many people there. There's also the sign-up sheet for if you want to bring something for Easter Sunday for the Easter egg hunt and coffee and donuts and such back there as well. And then I'd just like to remind everyone to please wait for the microphone during Joys and Concerns so that the people who are listening at home and who get the DVD recordings can share in those Joys and Concerns as well, because it doesn't make it onto the recording if we don't have the microphone.
I heard several of you mention that you had heard the service last Sunday and other times during this winter and COVID time, had watched it on TV, or not watched it on TV, but had heard it. That's something I commend to you to do, is that you do listen to it, get attached to it. It's an important part of your life. So anyhow, any others? Seeing none. Let me invite you to rise for a call to worship, turning to page 667. Start with the left, that would be this side. Ready? He is coming. In the pathways again.
He's coming.
Clear the pathway, raise the palms. He's coming, Son of David, suffering servant, Savior, risen Lord. Amen. First hymn is number 344.
There's no heat in the heat.
Can you play it through once? There you go. Let's sing. Come to the Lord with a moment of prayer, shall we? Let's pray. Almighty and loving God, who brings us together with a sense of redemption and power and love, who never lets us go, who watches over us daily, be with us as we come to worship right now, so that our hearts might feel and know your constant pressure upon us to do and to be your people. Help us, Heavenly Father, to live that way, not just in this room, but everywhere we go, with our neighbors, with our family, with our friends, and also with our enemies. We ask this, Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus the Christ, in whose name we pray. And all the people would say, Amen. Amen. You may be seated. And for a time of sharing, are there those that we need to remember today? Right up front.
Connie Blevins communicated with me this morning, and her friend Billy has been hospitalized again. I believe she's in Iowa, but I'm not positive. And the other thing is Bill Hare had internal bleeding 10 days ago now, and he was taken to KSB from Camp Emmaus, and then they transported him to OSF, did a lot of testing, never did isolate the internal bleeding. And this last Friday, he was taken to Pinecrest just for rehab. So keep Bill and Betty and Camp Emmaus also in your prayers.
Mm. And we oftentimes forget places that these things happen, and it can be very traumatic for everybody who is there because they care. That's why Camp Emmaus is there. So thank you.
I'd like to ask you to pray for our son Dominic. He's been admitted to the hospital, and we still don't know how he's doing. I thank you.
Sure. there.
I have two prayer requests. We know of a couple who were expecting a grandbaby, and it unfortunately passed away. It was supposed to be born last week, and it passed away about 4 days before it was due to be delivered. So please pray for their family. And then I would appreciate prayers for myself. I go back to see the doctor again on Tuesday, have an MRI, and see if they can do anything for my back.
Hang on a second. I got to get the names. And I didn't catch the first name.
The lady that lost her baby, her name was Sarah.
Sarah. And I should know yours, but I don't.
Connie.
Thank you, Connie. Connie, if it's any consolation, I have had 12 spinal surgeries. So let me tell you, there are some wonderful doctors out there that do some amazing things. So, you know, if it hadn't been for the work of the Lord and guiding me along the way, I would never have found that. You will be fine. I'm confident of that. Are there others? Well, then let's come before our Lord in a time of prayer. And I'm going to ask that we start off first in a moment of silent prayer. Would you bow with me? Heavenly Father, first we pray for Billy. We pray for Bill Hare. Pray for Dominic. We pray for Sarah. We pray for our own Connie. Father God, you are able to do far more abundantly than we either ask or think. And yet, Heavenly Father, when we ask, you respond with love and care. And you do so in such a way to inspire the body and the spirit, as well as any wound. We ask your blessing, Heavenly Father, upon those whom we have named today. You know them much better than any of us, but you know their bodies intimately. You're the one who knitted them and wove them together and made them into one being. And so there is no one who knows them like you do. Besides which, Heavenly Father, you're there for every event in their lives, for every birthday, every holiday, every event that hurt them, and every event that built them up. And so you responded to those. Father, I think out of all of these, I respond most to both Sarah and to Connie. And I pray, Heavenly Father, your special blessing upon them. We can't actually imagine for ourselves what that loss means, but that it is powerful. Now, as we come this Palm Sunday, we come with your love and with your care and ask your mercy. In the name of your Son, and our Savior, Jesus Christ, we ask this. And as he taught us, so now we would pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I remember leading that prayer for the first time in my first parish. And that was a little parish, actually just south of here, in a little rural enclave, actually in the middle of a cornfield. And I come from Evanston. I had grown up on the south side of Chicago. And so we started praying, and we got to the point, and the congregation said, "Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." And I was still going trespasses. I got through with that service, and I said to them, "Well, I guess we know which one of us is from Chicago." We have two hymns yet. Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. That's number 238. Would you turn to that, please, in your hymnal? For this morning is in fact the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem, which comes from Luke 19. And I'm reading from 28, verse 28 through 40. And this is the word of the Lord. When he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass, when they drew near to Bethphage and Bethany, at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village opposite you, where you will enter, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you why you are loosing it, thus you shall say to him, 'Because the Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went on their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosening the colt, the owners of it said to them, 'Why are you loosening that colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' Then they brought him to Jesus. They threw their own cloaks on top of the colt, and they sat Jesus on top of him. And as they went, many spread their cloaks on the way. Then as he was now drawing near to the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice and for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest of heavens.' And some of the Pharisees called to him from the crowd, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' But he answered and said to them, 'I tell you that even if these should keep silent, the very stones would immediately cry out.' This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Your King comes. Can you hear me if I stand over here? Or do I have to be behind the mic? Behind the mic. I got it. There's an interesting story coming out of the Old West. How many of you are Old West fans? Anybody here Old West fans? Any of you ever heard of a lady by the name of, what was her name? I got it here. Oh, yeah, Belle Starr. Anybody ever heard of Belle Starr? No? She was the most famous female outlaw. She was an outlaw. And there weren't very many female outlaws back then. But she was well known. She was pretty well known. She was so well known that when Judge Jacob Isaacs was calling everybody to court in his courtroom, he couldn't get anybody's attention. Because the bailiff had looked out the window and he said, "Isn't that Belle Starr?" And the whole room just swung to one side to look out to see Belle Starr. Now, I use that as an example to kind of get the idea of what was going on with Jesus. Jesus was not an outlaw, of course, but Jesus was well known. There were some who considered him, by Jewish law, an outlaw. I mean, he did certain things that they didn't appreciate. For example, he healed somebody on a Friday, which was a holy day. And he fed people on a Saturday, which is their holy day. And so these were all times that were just bothering people, bothering them terribly. And he did things that just kind of flew in the face of everything that they understood. Now, here is Jesus coming into town, and everybody wants to get a look. They heard the stories, but they had never seen him. Isn't that true for most of us? You ever want to see somebody special? I'm trying to remember the name of a football player that I had dinner with. Tells you how famous he was. But he came in and he sat down, and I remember him as being a very short guy. You know when they take these pictures on football fields and you look at the quarterback, they look so tiny and small compared to those linemen, as big as they are and how tall they are. Well, when I sat next to him, he was huge, just huge. And I could see all the pockmarks on his face from when he had had acne as a kid. You know how those things show up? And everybody just kind of looked at him and said, that doesn't look like him. Well, it was. Terry Bradshaw. How many of you ever met Terry Bradshaw? Anybody? He does a lot of personal things. So I had dinner with Terry Bradshaw. He looked different in life. Jesus probably looked different in life. And as he rode in, things began to change because people were not used to what he was doing. Let me start by saying, Jesus kind of came in funny. He came in riding on a mule, a donkey. How many of you have ever had a donkey? Anybody here ever had a donkey? Ever been around a donkey? I never have either, but I've heard plenty of stories. I've heard stories that they are belligerent. They won't move. You have to get back there and push their butt ends to try to get them to move. And even then, they won't move. I found out something in doing some research about this. There are plenty of donkeys in the Bible, by the way. Did you know that? There's actually a webpage. If you want to look this up after church, don't. It's called BibleDonkeys.com. BibleDonkeys.com. Honest, there is a webpage that talks just about Bible donkeys. BibleDonkeys.com. I found out that donkeys aren't belligerent. What donkeys are is very frightened. They don't like things that they don't recognize. They don't like things that are uncommon to them. Now, you can lead a donkey, but you have to do it gently. If you pull on them, they're not going to move. But if you walk by them, grab around, you know, the side of that jaw and just kind of pat them gently and lead, they'll follow you, particularly if they see you go. In other words, donkeys are very, very likely to follow a calm, solemn individual. Here was Jesus taking a donkey. Second thing to note is that the donkey was very similar to the donkey that his mother rode. Do you remember when the Christmas story began? That's why I wore this tie, by the way. I wore a Christmas tie because there's something of Christmas to the story. The donkey coming in was soft, was a colt, a little one, never been ridden on before. And yet Jesus could ride it. Striking, isn't it? A Sunday school teacher had read this story and asked his class, what did you get out of that story? And there, you know, how many of you have ever been in a Bible class where people want to answer all the questions right away? I've been in more Bible study classes where the class is quiet. I ask a question, everybody. But amazingly, there was this one young woman, always quiet, who raised her hand. And teacher's rather amazed, but kind of glad for somebody to say something. Yes. She said, well, the story told me that Jesus rode on a donkey, a quiet animal, an animal that needed to be loved and persuaded. Now, I don't know how many of you know me, but she said, I'm very quiet. And I'm afraid of most things and afraid of most people. But when I heard that Jesus had the encouragement to ride on this donkey, and he asked for a donkey, and not just a donkey, but a colt, a baby. And that's what he needed. Well, I decided that then I guess I am worthy to serve the Lord too, because I consider myself just a human donkey. Isn't that true? That Jesus uses us in times when we least expect it. Nobody goes out on a Friday afternoon to get something from the grocery store and find that there's somebody who has an issue going on. And how many times we just walk around that? But that opportunity is there for us to serve, to open our hearts, to give to that person who might be hurting, no matter what they are, no matter whether we know them or not. That's not important. Secondly, let's take a look at the crowd. Here's a crowd who gathered. It's like a famous person coming to town, like Bell Starr coming into town, like Terry Bradshaw showing up. Everybody wants to get a look. Everybody wants to get a peek. When we were first married, there was an exhibit at the Field Museum in Chicago. And one of my friends from high school had a father who was a docent. That's a person who kind of guides people around the museum, who got us tickets in to see somebody by the name of King Tut, King Tutankhamun, when he was in Chicago. And we went to see all of that exhibit, and the crowds were just pressing and pushing to get in. It was hard to get around. Well, that's what was going on with Jesus. The crowd was pushing, shoving, wanting to get a good look. They took off their coats, because there was something happening here with this guy coming in, and they thought he was going to go to Jerusalem and be crowned a king. That's what they were looking for. They were looking for King Jesus. And in order to get that idea, just look at what they were shouting. They're shouting, what? Hosanna, yes. Hosanna is out of the Psalm 118. It's part of the coronation story. That is a psalm that is read by all Jewish people. In fact, as well as we know Christmas hymns, this is a Jewish hymn, a hymn for the coronation. And Jesus was going to be coronated. So they took off their coats. They took the palm branches down to put something down so that the colt wouldn't touch the ground. So it'd always be on something. Boy, that poor colt, I felt sorry for him. But there he was, being guided by Jesus ever so gently along the pathway. And they were shouting, Hosanna! Hosanna! The word Hosanna, by the way, means save us now. Save now. Save now. Save us now. Now, good thing the Romans didn't understand Hebrew all that well, because that would have been a good sign that Jesus was there to do something else other than what they thought he was here for. They had viewed this guy coming in as being something special. Isn't it interesting that on Sunday, when Jesus is entering the town, the first day of the week, Jesus entering the town, and they're crying, Hosanna! Hosanna in the highest! And then on Friday, that very same crowd are shouting, Crucify him! Crucify him! How quickly they change. There is a baseball player out of Chicago who was once interviewed about his fame. And he said, I don't know that I'm so famous. And commentator said, why do you say that? He said, well, a couple of weeks ago, I was up to bat four times. First time, I hit a home run. Second time, I hit a home run. Third time, I got a double. The fourth time, I struck out. They cheered for the other three, but when I struck out, they booed. People are fickle. You know what I mean by fickle? They change their minds. They go back and forth, back and forth. It doesn't matter who you are or what you are. The whole difference of a crowd will change from moment to moment. Jesus experienced that. Thirdly, I want you to take a look at the Pharisees and their reaction. The Pharisees pointing out the fact that Jesus was not following the law. Was not following the law. They needed to be quiet. Now, please understand that the Pharisees are not bad people. The Pharisees are the conservative people of Jesus' day. They are the ones who are in power. They are very concerned about their constituents. And if the crowd got too loud or too large and started shouting things that the Romans did understand, they were very likely to have the Roman garrison emptied out. The Roman garrison was just a few feet away from where the temple was. And they would come out with their swords and spears and arrows and put a quick end to that crowd. And they were just simply trying to keep their people safe. But Jesus was pointing something out. It is inevitable. It is inevitable what's going to happen because we have set things in motion. God has taken charge. God is in power right now. And if this crowd were to be quiet, the stones upon which you stand will begin to shout and make noise. That's what's going to happen. They're going to make noise so loud that there'll be nothing you can do to quiet it down. This is all celebration, all joy, all power at this time. But it wouldn't be long before things would change. Everybody came to Jerusalem at Passover to make a note, make a point. I want you to listen for a moment. I've asked very graciously you were able to find it. The name of this video piece is called Watch the Lamb. It talks about a father and his two children whom he is bringing up to Jerusalem to sacrifice a lamb. Go ahead, please.
My two small sons, they walk beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the Lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. For there will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. I told them of Moses and Father Abraham. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. I stood there with my children in the midst of angry men. Then I heard the crowd cry out, part I did not wish to play. Why upon this day were men condemned to die? Why were we standing here where soon they would pass by? I looked and said, even now they come. The first one cried for mercy, the people gave him none. The second one was violent, he was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to the ground. I watched him as he struggled, I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back, the crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, to resist him. Then his hand reached for his sword, and so I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder and started down the street. The blood that he'd been shedding was running down my cheek. They led us to Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. And yet upon the cross, I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. Into thy hands I commit my spirit, he prayed, and then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I've lost all sense of time, until I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. The lamb ran away. Daddy, Daddy, what have we seen here? understand. So I took them in my arms, and we turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
There, in truth, is no one day for Palm Sunday. It's all one day. This whole week is one day. It starts now, but is inevitably it will work its way on, eventually to Jesus standing before a crowd, probably some of the same crowd. And when they ask, what should we do with this man, Jesus? They would shout, crucify him. He wasn't the political leader they thought he would be. He called for a new faith, a new understanding of faith, a new hope in God. Not an old idea of just following the law and being good people, but accepting God's forgiveness and mercy, taking up our cross daily, and following the example of the Lamb of God. Amen.
George, can I ask you a question?
You sure can. It's for the Latin letters, Jesus, a King of the Jews. And that was the political statement. That's why the Romans crucified him. Because he was proclaiming, they thought, as the Jews had said, this man says he's the King of the Jews. Scripture says, well, the Pharisees objected to that sign. Put up there instead, he said, I am King of the Jews. And Pilate responded back, what I have written, I have written. I'm not changing it. And so he died with a sign above him that said, this is the King of the Jews. Any other questions at that point? I appreciate the questions. If not, let me invite you to rise, if you would, to turn to page 240 in your hymnal.
Of your darkest.
learn of Jesus Christ to die. One thing is true, I think, for all of us, is we're dying. We are dying. Anyone want to disagree with that? Even down to the littlest one. She's dying. But we don't have to die. We have to live in Christ and follow the example of Christ to be sustained, to be given strength, to look forward to tomorrow, no matter what tomorrow brings. You are people of Jesus Christ. Come to celebrate the fact that He is here. He is coming. He is King. And what He is setting forth, while it may be hard to do and hard to watch, is really the beginning that we must go through if we are ever to get to Easter. Because without this, we never get there. Go with the understanding that while we may have to suffer, that suffering leads eventually to a resurrection day. Now, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, go in peace and with each other. And all the people would say,
Amen. Amen.